So before we get started, we just wanted to introduce ourselves today. My name is Andrea Mitran. I am one of your hosts. I am based right outside of DC in a town called Manassas, Virginia. I have been at Education Elements for about a year and a half now, and I'm part of our R&D team. Now I'll let Kim introduce herself next.
Yeah, thanks, Andy. So I'm Kimberly. I live in Manhattan Beach, which is in the LA area, and I'm a design principal and also supporting R&D, and super excited to get to chat with you all today. And then I'll hand it over to Drew to introduce himself.
Hey, good morning, everybody. I'm Drew Schantz, joining Kimberly on the West Coast here, but in the San Francisco Bay Area. Also a design principal at Education Elements and working with these two fine folks on our research and development team. Really excited to be with you this morning and to talk about moonshot mindsets and what that means for education. This is an opportunity for you to start to think about what are the things in your specific work that you think you can apply the moonshot mindset to solve some really significant challenges in education. We can see these examples happening in a few different ways already. So the idea of classroom design, we all know those black and white pictures of students in rows facing one direction in a classroom. Unfortunately, in some cases, we've had to go back to students sitting in rows facing one direction just because of the nature of what we're dealing with right now. But putting that aside, we've really used a lot of understanding how students learn best and together practices of architecture, sociology, art, kind of all together to reimagine spaces so that they work best for the people who are in them, particularly teachers and students. So a moonshot in the classroom redesign has been to take classrooms from something that looks more like the picture in the upper left-hand corner to something that looks like this illustration here, where students are participating in differentiated activities in a number of different mediums. The space is very flexible. The space is very technology integrated. We've got some virtual reality going on here. We've got students all working on different projects. It seems like things that they are passionate about. So for classroom design and learning experience design, be reflective of something like this, of this illustration. Similarly to tech-enabled learning, the technology that students had access to was not a tablet that we know it right now, but a slate tablet where they would write things down. So from there, we've been able to jump significantly to a place where we're thinking about virtual reality and how can we immerse students in learning experiences in a virtual reality setting. In the middle here, we had things like the overhead projector and that infamous AV cart that students would roll around. I know we can all probably remember having those rolled into our classrooms. But this kind of goes back to the point that we were making earlier, that it's not just about going from the tablet to virtual reality. There are some steps in the middle that we do have to take to get to these moonshot places. So while moonshots take time and while there need to be some steps in the middle from where we are to where we want to be, that's by no means a write-off of quote unquote impossibility of what the future might hold. So I'm just thinking right now, were there people sitting in 17th or 19th and 18th century classrooms with those tablets thinking about virtual reality? Probably not. But in a 20th century classroom, perhaps. Maybe one of these students right here pushing the AV cart was thinking, you know, it would be so much better if everyone just had their own virtual reality set so I wouldn't have to lug this TV all around the school. Who knows? But it takes visionaries and people who are thinking not just 5 years from now, but 10 and 20 years from now of what's going to be possible to better meet the needs of the educational experience. To do that, it's really helpful to have a thought-provoking question to guide that work and to guide that thinking. So what I have up here is a list, IDEO, and this bulleted list here. It's actually from IDEO and the Stanford D School, but it's a couple of different lenses through which to look at a question and to reframe a question, push yourself in a new direction. So through the context of education, a how might we question, or you'll see an example of a what if question as well, but a how might we question to kind of get our moonshot mindset going that amplifies the good or amps up the good is how might we leverage the flexibility that distance learning has afforded to many students to reimagine what we now know as the classroom. Could this be an opportunity for us to maybe literally or figuratively break down classroom walls and expand the learning space, not just to those four walls, but to the community at large? So can we use this opportunity to redefine what a classroom looks like and amp up the good that has come from the flexibility that distance learning has afforded many students? So just one example there. Another example, if we wanted to remove the bad, we talked about this briefly earlier, but what if internet access was free for every student? A pretty big, audacious, question that we don't have an easy answer to. But by identifying the challenge that we've often run into for students not having reliable internet access, what if we could just make that free for every student? What would we need to have in place for that to happen? And then one more example here. One of my favorites is creating an analogy from a need or a context. So how might we make the learning experience more like a video game? Or how might we make it more like a carnival or a family reunion? What are the things that really spark joy and enjoyment in our students? And how can we radically transform what the learning experience looks like to make it more enjoyable for them? So just some ways to kind of push your thinking in different ways. And this resource, again, from the Stanford D School is a great way to, or a great reference to take the questions, the what if questions that you have, and to think about them in different ways. Some other examples here that you can touch on and think about. So what if schools celebrated failed efforts instead of just successful ones? What if school policy mandated that teacher speaking never exceed 20% of overall conversation in a classroom? That's an interesting one. What if the measure of a great school was when students were teaching most of the time and teachers were learning most of the time? What if teachers had a board of directors that included entirely of students to whom they reported and gained input for their work as an educator? Maybe some of you who are teachers and listening right now are a little uneasy in your seats because these are definitely challenging notions of teachers, students, and their classrooms. But if we're not asking questions that push our thinking and make us uncomfortable, then there's really no way that we can achieve that moonshot mindset. We have to get a little bit uncomfortable and challenge the status quo if we're going to get to that new reality that we want to get to.